Thank you. I appreciate you having us on board. Dr. Laffey is the medical director for the STARS program, and I asked him last minute to just go ahead and join in case there were any answers, any questions that arose that he might want to weigh in on as well. But again, I sincerely appreciate the opportunity to be able to present to you all. Pediatric patients with complex medical needs are my passion. I run the STARS program here at Cardinal Glennon Children's. And for those of you who aren't familiar with the STARS program, I can't really wrap it into a really accurate small package of a description here because it's very broad. But what our end goal is to improve emergency care for children with medical complexities, and both in the pre-hospital setting and in the emergency room as well. So we create emergency plans for them that take into consideration the scope of EMS providers and the abilities of community emergency departments and pediatric tertiary center emergency departments as well. And we provide a lot of education. Our team mantra is one kid counts. That comes from the fact that we consider each and every child in our program to matter. They matter a whole lot to their families, and they also matter to us, to their clinical teams. And we want them to have the best outcomes possible if they have that sometimes inevitable emergency once they leave the four walls of our hospitals. So when I do the trach lecture, I like to add, of course, pictures of all of our kids, but I especially like to add photos of our very vibrant kids, because I think that at times what we find is that there's an unfortunate assumption that a child with a tracheostomy or a child on a ventilator is at risk or has already just a poor prognosis. You know, the outcome is going to be poor anyway. We've heard that, but that's just not the case. We have plenty of kids who are able to kick that vent and that trach and live very happy, long, typical lives. So we'll go ahead and start with our situation and why we're here. So when I started at Cardinal Glennon, I'm a paramedic by trade, a little background on me. I've been a paramedic for 24 years, and the majority of my career has been spent in the pre-hospital. When I first started Cardinal Glennon, they had interest in STARS for all of the children with special needs, but the big focus was these trach patients. I almost was met with hostility in some situations when talking to some of our caregivers in the PICU and the NICU and our respiratory therapists when I identified myself as a paramedic and what I was trying to do. And I actually was asked at one point, oh, well, you're a paramedic. Aren't you supposed to be an airway guru? Why can't you handle, you know, a child with a tracheostomy? And I started thinking about it. And I was very comfortable with trachs, but my comfort level with trachs came from personal experiences as a person having a, you know, being the daughter of a person with a tracheostomy and also working in the critical care setting and ICU prior to getting into the EMS field. And the more I thought of it, I'm like, you know, I don't know that we covered trachs at all in paramedic school. If we did, it didn't leave an impact because I can't remember what we covered. But I know we didn't talk about emergency trach changes or different types of trachs. So we started doing a little bit more digging into the situation that we had at hand. I advertised that I would do some case reviews. So I wanted to give some examples of what we found when we went and we did this digging. What went wrong during these calls, and were these calls actually occurring? So I added two pre-education reviews, and we finish up, I'll go ahead and wrap us up with two case reviews that are going to go ahead and show a better outcome. But this call, actually, I can't accurately call pre-STARS, because this was a call that occurred while I was here at Cardinal Glennon, because I was monitoring all of the dispatches that came out for our STARS patients. This unfortunately was an agency that had not necessarily complied with training. So I got the page from our dispatch center, our large St. Louis County dispatch center, that a STARS call had been dispatched. And from there, I tend to fixate on notes until the call is done. This one is hard to even review, to look at, to remember this case. But, you know, I saw the notes that mom had called. It was a third party call. She was not at home, and she was calling for the caregiver at home, which she identified as the aunt, and said that, you know, my baby has a trach, she's on a vent, she's trying to bag her, but it won't work. And there's just a panic, it's not working, she can't get it to work. At 6 minutes, the fire crew arrived and they called out a respiratory arrest. At 9 minutes, we had the fire crew, the same crew, go ahead and call out this as a full cardiac arrest. EMS arrived at the 10 minute mark, and at the 14 minute mark, so 4 minutes after arriving at that home, they were already beating feet to the hospital, which is another thing that we often try to teach, and Dr. Laffey, especially since he's our PALS champion, is we really need to be spending time on scene, even though this is an extremely anxiety provoking situation. But minute 26, they arrived at the hospital. So what we knew is that this was a baby who was reportedly, breathing, had a pulse when the pumper crew arrived, but quickly lost it. I understand you cannot read the narrative here, but we pulled out the important aspects that we wanted to highlight. So they did successfully place an IO, which was fabulous. And they got, they had their first dose of Epion. There was a little bit of question with the depth of the compressions and the ratio, but you know, it was documented that they were bagging the whole time with 15 liters. So at the, I highlighted that last point because what struck me is that they did try to put this baby on capnography, which is something that we really, really preach. And unfortunately, they said it was unsuccessful. So to define unsuccessful, when I went back and reviewed strips, I saw that it was picking up, but it was showing a zero. So we all know that at some point they should have had some kind of CO2 return. So when I reviewed this with their medical director, this is something we really focused on, the missing elements of the actual respiratory assessment. Are we ventilating this baby? We were bagging, but were we actually successfully ventilating? And that's something that unfortunately wasn't documented well enough for us to say, yes, they had a patent airway while that child was in their hands. So at the receiving facility, they did find, and not surprisingly, that trach was dislodged. It was completely out of the stoma, which is something we're going to talk about a little bit later on in the presentation, but that's honestly a common presentation that we see. That these babies, they decannulate easily and with their ties still in place underneath the drain sponge, covered by clothing, little baby neck rolls, and it's not obvious unless you're actually really focusing on that assessment, that you're recognizing that you are or aren't ventilating this baby, or you just have to honestly take a look. So while there's no proof of when this decannulation actually happened, what we don't have is proof that she was being ventilated when she was in the hands of EMS, and we don't have proof that she was being ever ventilated by the aunt in the home. So this unfortunately is another case of an infant who was just a preemie. She was what I've learned our NICU calls a feeder and grower. They just want her to mature a little bit more. And she had BPD and she just needed that support from her vent until her lungs matured. And until her airway was able to mature a little bit as well. She was neurologically intact. Unfortunately, after this incident, she was neurologically devastated. And 24 hours later, the family made the very difficult decision to go ahead and just remove her from life support. For case number two, I do not have the EMS document, but what I do have is the documentation of the community hospital. This was a case in which the patient was transported to an outside hospital, and then an interfacility transport was done by our transport team to get him to us. So this was a little bit older. This was an 11-month-old baby who, this is the first note is the nurse's note. The second note you see is the physician note. So they say he arrived, EMS reported they arrived on scene that he was sagging 80% and pulses were at 50 and rapidly dropping. So they went ahead and initiated CPR. I did review this case with the EMS crew and with the mother afterwards. And what was clearly shared from both sides made sense was that mom did say at one point, okay, she got her wits together. We need to change the trach. We need to check the trach. EMS thought they were doing the right thing by saying, no, he's crashing. We need to go. The last thing we need to do is pull an airway, because that's how they viewed it, as we're going to just take the airway away. When in fact, that airway was not patent. The trach that was in place was serving not as an airway adjunct at that time, but as an airway obstruction. So they did their best. They worked a fantastic code, except for the fact that they didn't have a patent airway the entire time. So upon arrival, they did find that he was completely plugged. This physician, this is an adult attending who was, like, I guess, more comfortable intubating, which is fine. He was able to intubate this child, which is something we're going to discuss too, because some of our kids, you just can't. But he was successful in the intubation and they got Rosk back with one round of epi, and they had a hemodynamically stable patient at that point when our transport team arrived. So same kid, this is the last note I have from him in our Epic system prior to this event taking place. And this was just a follow-up visit with his pulmonologist. And you can see that he was already doing some trials off the vent just on trach collar successfully. He was using a speaking valve for several minutes a day, no recent illness. And he was just growing, developing, and he was on track to successfully kick that trach in that vent. That was the goal. He was rolling over, reaching for things, and starting to be more and more social. Unfortunately, this is his post-arrest assessment, which did not improve. So he has, you know, does not blink to threat. He has constant abnormal movements, which are honestly extremely difficult to distinguish between seizures and just the dystonia that he has chronically every day. And that's the life he lives. He's still with us today. And I still keep in touch with his mother. And neither of us, she doesn't blame the EMS crew. I don't blame the EMS crew. That's horrible. But we both agree that absolutely this is a situation that needs to be fixed. We can't expect EMS to act on these with competence and confidence when the information was not ever taught to them in the first place. And in fact, sometimes the exact opposite, the wrong information is sent their way. So we took a look, we took an even deeper dive. We have these cases, I had the second case I knew about, the first case we reviewed, was after, but I wanted to look back and see how often this was actually happening, how prevalent it was, because I knew that in order to make change, I really had to prove that this was happening to more than one or two. we know with our team and at Cardinal Glennon that just one counts, hence our team motto. But when you're talking to the masses, they want to know that this is a big enough problem to address head on. So I took our list of tracheostomy patients from our ENT department, and it took a long time, but I reviewed every emergency call for these children between 2010 and 2018, and then picked out the ones who arrived via EMS and the calls that were specifically for respiratory distress. And what we found out of those are 19 near misses, which were children who had significant decline during transport as noted by arrival vital signs and assessment in comparison to the first notes of the attending at the bedside in the emergency room. We had 6 patients who suffered severe neurological injury that was irreversible. These are children who have daily seizures, who do not interact with their outside environment, who are fully dependent on ventilators and G-tubes to keep them alive. And we had 5 deaths. When we looked through the neurological injuries and the deaths, you can say with certainty that each one, when they arrived, they either arrived with a fully plugged trach or a completely decannulated trach. So we can see where the issue lies. Why? You know, why is this happening? You know, I already mentioned before, looking back to paramedic school, I couldn't remember had I had that trach training and what did they teach me. So we started, you know, surveying our paramedics and asking our paramedics in the St. Louis area and surrounding counties. We're right on the river, for those of you who aren't familiar with our area. So we do a lot of work with Illinois as well. And what we came up with in 2016 was that 62% of paramedics reported out of this anonymous survey that prior to our classes, they'd never had any formal training on tracheostomies, especially specific to pediatric patients. In 2018, we were fortunate enough to be invited on a webinar with Dr. Peter Antevi on just this subject because he found it very important as well. And he's like, let's repeat it nationally. We had a very large audience, and this was a mixed group of nurses, paramedics, EMTs, and physicians. And we kind of got the same results. That came back with 60% having said they'd never had any formal training like this before. We also went looking at different protocols. I know all the states are different. Some states have state protocols, some just, you know, follow national guidelines. Missouri is one of those states that does not. It's up to the medical directors, which we have 100 throughout the state, to write protocols for their systems. And we found some that were concerning. So we found plenty that just prohibited paramedics and EMTs from doing anything past suctioning a trach. We found ones that allowed family members only to remove a trach or EMS to remove a trach, but they couldn't reinsert the trach. No consistency throughout, and a lot of things that just honestly weren't correct. Also, in speaking with a lot of these EMS educators and the EMS medical directors about, hey, let's take a look at this and see how we can fix it, it was obvious that there were a lot of misconceptions out there about how these kids are when they're sent home. There were a lot of questions about, well, what about stay sutures? I was like, oh gosh, no, we absolutely don't send kids home with stay sutures. They have proven tracks with their stomas. They've had multiple changes while they're here. And when they go home, we are sending them home knowing that they have a secure stoma with a trach that can easily be taken in and out. We found a lot that just assumed that all trachs have that inner cannula, which is not true. The majority of our patients don't. They just have a single trach tube, which we'll look at a little bit later in the presentation. And you know, they really felt that this was a truly advanced skill that could only be done by ENTs or pulmonologists or subspecialties within the hospital. And we're like, oh no, quite the contrary. We have parents are taught to do this, not only for emergencies, but they change these trachs on a routine basis. Most of our kids get their trachs changed weekly or biweekly, and they have to have a second person in the home who's also trained to change those trachs. And that's not always a spouse or a grandmother. We have plenty of single moms out there who find a best friend who's close and local, and that person comes up and, no matter what their background is, sits at the bedside, learns how to do an emergency trach change, and they check that box that the secondary caregiver is in place to watch this child. So really, it's not considered an advanced procedure within the hospital. It's just something that's almost every day and typical. What we also know is this population is booming. We have not run our growth from 2019 to 20 yet, but for an AAP project, we looked at our growth in this population from 2018 and 19. We had a 40% increase in the children that received tracheostomies just from our hospital alone. So we know that we're just seeing more and more and more of these kids hit our communities. Our recommendations from our team, and I wrote these without Dr. Laffey reviewing it, but I think he would agree, is that we think we need to, this needs to be an included skill in EMT and paramedic basic curriculum. This is something that medics need to be very competent and confident in when they leave medic school. We have some programs in the area who have us come out and teach, or they're very comfortable teaching it themselves after some train the trainer sessions. And we've seen a lot of successes with their paramedics when they go out into the field and they see our kids. And we need to make sure that if this is added into curriculum, that the people, the educators, have the tools and the knowledge to deliver this education with proficiency. We get some gasps sometimes, and people think that it's a little much to ask, but we actually are of the opinion that we think that this should be a skill that EMTs should be allowed to perform, especially if they're on their own in a case where there is impending arrest or this child is in respiratory distress due to having an unstable airway. I can quote Dr. Laffey by saying it's clearing an airway obstruction, quite frankly. And I know a lot of the argument will be this is something that the parents are trained to do and they should be doing it, not relying on EMTs. But for the majority of our cases in which we've had negative outcomes or challenges with it at all, that trained caregiver isn't there or has gone into panic mode and isn't doing what they were trained to do. So I like to say, I was a trach family member. My dad had a trach, and I never ever called 911 for an audience. Trach changes were just part of everyday life, and it's something that we did. If it wasn't patent, we changed it. We certainly didn't call 911. So when an ambulance is being summoned for an airway issue, typically that caregiver isn't on scene. I did notice that the NAEMSP guidelines looks like they've been updated because the 2019 ones are pretty good. And I just have them up here for review if any of you haven't looked at them recently. But the only thing that I would mention for pediatrics, and this, it's not a make or break, these are very well written, is that, not all of our kids have a cuffed trach. We often do cut, we trim ET tubes to place into the stoma. One thing that I know our NICU would cringe at that, especially our ENT department, because they're concerned about creating any type of sharp edge on the distal end and sticking it in that delicate little airway when they have the little ones. But I just wanted to put those up there because I liked them. They actually include trach changes if they after suctioning there's a failure to clear. So I just wanted to review a little bit about trachs. Our full trach lecture is an hour just on tracheostomies. different types of airway malformations, speaking valves, filters, everything you could ever want to know about trachs. But I think it's okay to know the basics. I think just having the basics is enough to be able to save a life, which is pretty important. So again, with our kids, very, very rare that we have a Schiele trach that's fenestrated or has that double lumen. In fact, I had to chuckle because I've been teaching this for so long, and we've, with COVID, have had a few adult patients come over, and through our trach team and our safety huddles in the morning, there is a notice that went around about how to handle a trach that had a double lumen and how to take that out, because we just don't have it. Our kids just usually have a single tube. It's very flexible, very soft, and some are surprised that it is so soft. It's about the consistency, most of them. Some are firmer, but most of them, the bavona, which is the most common, is almost the consistency of like a nasal trumpet. So you can see how easily it can become dislodged just with movement and shifting around. But they do get change, like I said, weekly or biweekly, and these kids go home with a proven safe stoma. So something else I wanted to mention, and I have a picture of two different kids who illustrate the two different issues why they have trachs, is that we have our population of children that go home with their trach because they require either full-time or part-time assistance from a ventilator. And then we have our kids that are going home with a trach because they have to bypass an anatomical airway obstruction. And that's something that we really need to think about when we're teaching about trachs in the pediatric population, is that we can't just assume that they can go ahead and move to the upper airway to ventilate all of these kids, because we do have a significant percentage of them where that's not going to be an option. My buddy Nathaniel, who's in the picture prior, go back one, Nathaniel with the fire hat on, he in fact is one of those very rare children who had such a significant airway malformation. He was not going to be a candidate for repair ever. He traveled to Cincinnati multiple times for assessment, and they actually made the determination that the safest option for him was to do a complete laryngotracheal separation. So this is a child who has no connection to his upper airway at all. All he has is a simple breathing stoma. Again, we have cuffed and uncuffed trachs. I don't have anything to cite for this, but typically I see cuffed trachs more often in children who spend time on vents. If you have a kid with an uncuffed trach, you should be highly suspicious that this is a kid who probably has an anatomical airway malformation. I'm sorry, anatomical airway obstruction and going on. And I have illustrations of some of the more significant ones that we see. And as you can see, you're not going to be able to ventilate very well through the upper airways when you've got this going on. They are meant to be soft and flexible. They're meant to sit midline in the trachea and not cause any irritation on the tracheal walls. We have some where you can see in the first picture with the uncuffed trach that have what we call the flexed end. So it has an extension to allow for more movement to hopefully prevent that dislodgement. And also for some of our kids who have a couple chins, that allows it to extend far enough so that we can ventilate them. But something else I want to point out with the cuff, and you do have a cuff that's fully inflated, you completely take away the ability for that child to bypass the trach and breathe around it if they have the ability. I don't know if you all can see my pointer, but with the cuff deflated, some of our kids, not all, but it buys you a little bit of time because they can actually have an alternative pathway to breathe. Our rules for EMS, something that we really like to drive home, is the trach is the problem until proven otherwise with our kids. We don't care what you're there for. If they're seizing, bleeding, if it's a traumatic injury, we want to know before you move on in your assessment that A is intact, it's covered, it's in place. So we say, is it clear and is it in the stoma? So we've taught all the people we teach them immediately look under those drain sponges and make sure that that trach is actually in the stoma, because it can be, it can really fool you, as illustrated in these two pictures. This, I don't know if you can see, I meant to change this out for our, to our most recent trach plug picture that Dr. Laffey actually received as the attending in the ED, but this is an example of how plugged they can get. EMS actually did a trach change for this one and sent me that photo because they were very proud of themselves. And I was proud of them too. And I said, thank you, I'm putting that into a presentation. But that's a full, complete plug there.
Hey, Patricia, I'm sorry to interrupt you. We had a question.
Sterile water versus air? Is that so? Usually, typically there with sterile water, air can, hair has more of a tendency to leak. Saline can crystallize. For pressures, Dr. Laffey, do you have any other answer for why they use water?
No, I mean, I think that that's the reason that the air is more likely to kind of diffuse out of the cup and deflate it. But certainly air is not wrong, right? I mean, I don't even know that there's anything been kind of proven on that or if it's ever been clinically significant. So, I don't want to mention that putting air into the cup would be somehow problematic. That's not the case.
And honestly, I think that it would be safe to say if you don't know the cuff inflation, I would err on the side of not inflating the cuff.
Right.
I can ventilate them okay, because over inflating on a kid can cause a lot of problems and there is no set amount for each one. So we'd like to put that on their emergency plans, but if it's not there or nobody can tell you, so I said I would try to ventilate without and then inflate.
Gently.
Maybe a half a mil at a time, like if that was a problem.
Yeah, it's exactly right. As you're listening to ventilation and hearing the leak, you can just inflate until you no longer hear the leak. That's probably the safest way to do it if you don't know what volume to use.
Awesome. I think that definitely answers the question. I just wanted to ask before we move too far on.
Sure. I was trying to type out a response and it was taking too long, so I apologize.
No problem at all.
So again, is it clear? Is it in the stoma? Those are our rules. And if not, fix it before you do anything else. One other thing I didn't note in the prior slide when I was talking about cuffed and uncuffed trachs is that you'll know if you have which one you're dealing with by the presence or absence of a pilot balloon. So it's as simple as that. If they have a cuffed trach, you'll see that pilot balloon hanging out. So absolutely, if you go back to the NAEMSP guidelines, if you are going to pull that trach, yeah, you need to deflate it first, because that is another error that we see sometimes. Again, my hour-long trach lecture goes over every type of trach, but we also have foam trachs that automatically inflate that you have to do the, you have to suck out the air before you, that is air, before you pull it, but once it's placed, it automatically just inflates itself. They have all different nifty types of new ones out there, but that what you see here, the Bavona type with the water, is the most common. So when we go step by step, again, we want to assess under the drain sponge, the neck rolls, clothing, make sure it's there. And then if it is, you know, let's prove patency. We used to say if you could pass the suction catheter, then you could say it was patent, but that's not necessarily true, because we've seen plenty where the mucus plug has just stuck on the end of that French cath and they're able to push it out, but then pull it right back up against the end of the trach, the distal end. So you've got to assess in different ways. You have to see that your patient's improving with suctioning, that you have clear lung sounds. And what we really want to see on every single patient, to not just prove to us that you have a good airway and to have, you know, the kid improve and improve outcomes, but to protect yourself as a pre-hospital provider, as an emergency provider, document just as you would a patient that you have who's intubated in the back of your ambulance, you have, it is completely inappropriate to show up at the hospital with an intubated patient that's not on continuous waveform capnography these days. We should be, have the same thought process for a child with a tracheostomy. So we really want to see that we're watching in title the entire time, and that's, it's clearly documented. Yes, I know that while this child was in my hands, I did everything I could to prove that this kid had a great airway and I took care of it if it wasn't. And again, if you can't prove that patency, you have any question, or this kid's just not improving or continues to go the wrong way, they decline, we just, we've got to do an emergent trach change. In fact, one of the sayings of our pulmonary department and our ENT is, when in doubt, change it out. And when you read notes from parents calling in with any type of struggle, even with vent alarms that are bothering them, the very first thing they have them do is change the trach, and then they go through troubleshooting because they want to make sure they're starting out with a clear patent trach before they go fixing things that don't need to be fixed. Suctioning. I was taught when I was in the ICU before we had the fancy cough assist devices that we have now, and we just did manual chest PT, that we could go ahead and just bury that suction catheter until we tapped the carina and induced a really forceful cough, because that was sometimes a benefit. But we know that with our kids, we have better ways of inducing coughs, and we have machines that can safely do that for us now, and that we can actually not only damage and cause bleeding to the carina, but we can desensitize it over time and actually make their cough reflex less and less. Another issue is you really don't want to vagal a baby that you're already, you know, having struggles with, and you're going to have a potential for bradycardia anyway. I actually got to see that in the PICU when I was following Dr. Laffey's wife, just to learn more about these kids. I saw them suction a little guy and he bradied down and he did a cough brady routine cycle. And they honestly just said, you're just gonna go back to sleep, and they sedated him. So that we just wanna stay off. So depth does matter. No longer than 5 seconds, twirl, get that in and out. Allow them to rest in between. I know I'm one who can sometimes get a little bit aggressive with suctioning and not allow that patient the time to really rest and recover between. Saline's your friend. We also have, you know, a lot of hesitancy from providers to actually, like, I don't want to induce something into the airway that's foreign, and that seems, you know, the opposite of what we want to do, contrary to what we want to do. But their airways, we have to keep in mind, are chronically dry, because they're bypassing their natural ability to moisturize their lungs. They're breathing through an sometimes open hole in their neck, which is not safe. So saline will help loosen secretions and can usually help you out a whole lot. We also teach how to suction with both a free open French cath and how to use the numbering, and then how to suction with the inline catheter. We usually have to point out, I always point out, that while that pediatric inline suction is colored, it has rainbow colors, that does not match Braslow. That's just so you can see those numbers easier when you're, you know, going, looking through the plastic as your guide. So if the tube is removed and you can't get it back in, because there is, that could happen, you could have a difficult recannulation, it's definitely not unheard of. We always teach that the patients are supposed to have a smaller size trach. Some of our kids have two half sizes smaller in case of a difficult recannulation. Try lubing the tube, try repositioning. But absolutely, if you need to grab an ET tube because that trach is no longer, you don't have a new one, or the trach you pulled, you can't reinsert, grab the ET tube. It's not the best airway, but it's an airway, and we'll take an airway over none. And we'll defend you if RT or the floors have any problems with it. But to compare, you can look at the inner diameter of the trach, which is typically written there on the flange, and that's the same, correlates with the same size as your ET tube. So you can use that as a guide, whether, and then if you want to go smaller too with a really difficult one.
So we're on scene with a baby who we just popped off the vent. She was throwing high pressure alarms. She's desatting on us. She doesn't look so great. We've attempted suctioning. I've assessed her trach to make sure it's in place. I've assessed patency, and she's becoming a little bit more difficult for me to bag again. I'm worried that she's going to start braiding on us, and I've determined that I think it's time for an emergency trach change. So, guys, let's get her supplies ready.
Okay. I'm going to go find get her trach bag. We made sure that we didn't leave it. Okay. So it's got all of her supplies in here. I'm going to find that trach the same size for you.
I'm going to go ahead and have you start bagging her over the nose and mouth. To do that, I'm going to ensure that we have this cuff deflated since we just pulled her off the vent.
Hey, Trisha, there's also a size smaller in here if you get needed, okay?
Thank goodness. I'm going to try to suction one more time. Oh, yeah, I'm not getting really anywhere with that. Let's get her in the proper position. I'm going to position her with a towel roll underneath. Let's get her hyperextended here so we can really expose that area. Can you go ahead and get her ties undone for me?
Her ties are undone. The cuff is deflated.
Okay, great. On my count, 3, 2, 1, I got this new trach ready to go. I'm passing it. I'm going to pull out my obturator. Can you get those ties down for me?
Yep.
And then let's go ahead and bag her again right away from bag to trach.
Okay, and I'm going to go ahead and reinflate this with the water that came out of the old trach. Okay, you're
how
reinflated.
How is she bagging?
Much easier.
Oh, good. I'm going to take a listen here. Oh, I've got much better aeration. Good. How does she look on the monitor, guys?
Yeah, she's actually picking her heart rate back up and her oxygen saturation's coming up, too.
Oh, her color looks much better, too. Good job, everybody.
This is a tracheostomy algorithm that we made for our team that's in our field guide for paramedics in emergency rooms, both pre-hospital and in the hospital to follow, just to kind of help you out along the way. Of course, who wants to read a detailed algorithm when you're working against the clock with an airway, right? But it's there, hopefully, to read beforehand. But our transport rules are, don't ever, ever, ever transport without the go bag, which should have extra trach ties, a spare trach, a trach that's a size smaller in case of that difficult recannulation. They have a wedge, which I have. I can show you all, I can dig out, but which will help when things get wet and slimy. So you can pop off speaking valves and pop off the BVM, pop off the vent, whatever you need with ease without having to feel like you're pulling on everything else. Everything you need basically. And then working suction at all times next to that patient, because occasionally I work for St. Louis City part-time still, and we occasionally don't have the most fantastic equipment. So there are times when we'll see, I don't have really adequate suction. So I want the patients there. And always, always, like you mentioned before, you want that end title. So this is the wedge, which I don't know if you guys can see, get it in the camera view. And what that allows you to do is just simply, this is a little bit larger trach size, pop off that, any cap you might have in place. A lot easier with their speaking valves and HMEs. But in teaching this to paramedics to prepare a course, I think that it could easily be done. If you're not comfortable with teaching it yourself, which I think anybody could be with time and preparation, but I think that if you would contact your local pediatric hospital, if you have one available, they would most likely be more than happy and excited actually to come out and help out, hopefully. We are always willing to provide scenarios, training videos. We have a couple different training videos out there. The Hands Heavy webinar is very popular in content. We provide scenarios and content for our state EMSC leaders when they go out and they do their training. Hands-on practice with trach dolls, which we're going to look at how you could make one actually, which are very low cost, a very low investment. Or if you know these kids, invite them post pandemic. Hopefully we can get back there. Invite them to come in. I think their parents usually are very open to that and excited to help. that's a trach poster we have that we would also be more than happy to share with anyone that we made for ERs. It's really big, but it's just like a trauma poster or a PALS poster, only it just has step-by-step of how to work with a trach that's not stable. But a lot of people say, oh, I need a trach mannequin, and we lend our trach mannequins out all the time, but I was fortunate enough to get a grant so I could have several trach mannequins and all of the bells and whistles I wanted. Like you see, I have the speaking valves, I have the HME caps, but this is what our EMSC did to lend out, is they just took a regular, any regular plastic doll that drill a hole, just like a hand drill, drill a hole, and voila, they have a trach. They have a trach mannequin. Trach tubes, I constantly collect our expired trach tubes and I lend them to our EMSC leaders when I get in touch with them, but they also give them to us for training. So there's a chance that your hospital may be willing to lend them to programs as well. Otherwise, ordering those individually aren't near as costly as you may think, or as trying to actually order the $500 to $800 mannequins. And then you can make a backpack out of all of those supplies that can serve as your go bag for training scenarios. And you can hand that off to students to be able to go through a trach emergency. So as you can see, there's a packet of scenarios laminated that the EMSC has that we made to go through. And we'll actually get on and do video sim for them and with them too at times. So training works. We've proven that actually, you know, training works. It really boosts confidence. And here's some post-training calls that we celebrated. So this is a little guy who, again, just to illustrate, he was not with his typical caregiver. So he was left at home with someone who wasn't trained. They called 911 for difficulty breathing. They'd met this kid already through the STARS program, and they knew he just didn't look right. By the time they got him to the ambulance, they noticed he had become decannulated, and oh my gosh, there's a plug on the end of it too. We had both going on. They changed it, reinserted a fresh trach. He was great. They transported, but he was discharged like an hour later. So we were really, really excited about this outcome. And then even more so for the next. I know this is incredibly hard to read, but this was an infant who was also a BPD-er who had a great prognosis. And mom was there, and mom was fantastic, but we had just upsized him. And this was one of those issues where after they upsized him, it was difficult to recannulate him. And she had struggles. She couldn't get the trach back in. She was alone. This is not really a one-person friendly procedure when you have a kid fighting you. They called me after this call, as they usually do. The medics did, and they said, oh my gosh, he was gray. He was still fighting, but we knew he wasn't going to fight much longer. They tried to reinsert the 4-0, couldn't. And from training, they were able to calmly remember that there should be a smaller trach in the house and said, mom, do you have your smaller trach? Do you have your emergency trach? Yes. She grabbed it, gave him a 3.5. They were able to get the 3.5 in, and he immediately came back. He came back actually, then they sat it again, and they said, well, let's check the vent, as we taught them to do too. And they found that some vent tubing had become dislodged in all of the excitement. So they fixed that too. And they transported because they were really worried about how gray he had gotten, and they were worried he had potentially aspirated during this event, but he was discharged from our emergency room 4 hours later. And that is him a couple weeks after the call. I did a photo shoot with Sean. And today he is decannulated wild. And I get chills every time I see him running around the floor when he's in house. So, you know, again, training does work. So I finished at an hour, which I'm right under an hour, which I'm impressed with. Do you guys have any questions? Because we're very open for them, or we can review more content if you'd like as well.
We have received a few questions actually, and one of them is right in this vein of training, but it's relating to training of parents, do you, so how does that usually work for you? Do you often encourage them? Do you even have to, or are they normally seeking out this knowledge of how to use suction at home, or how to go through some of these processes themselves? Or do you have a program set up for them?
Absolutely. There's step-by-step procedures before they can take patients home. They have to spend 24 hours at the least at the bedside alone. So nurses observe them for 24 hours. That includes a trach change during that time. They have to prove proficiency with, I believe, at least 2 trach changes on their own. And then, like I said, there has to be a secondary caregiver who's trained as well. If this is a single parent, they have to prove that they have someone else who they can have as a relief caregiver who's also trained. So they go through suctioning, you know, troubleshooting, emergency trach changes, CPR. They go through everything with them. But what we see is, unfortunately, we, you know, aspects that we can't control are them not being there, them panicking. They're told they're supposed to be there. But another thing we also see is them, an assumption that they're nurse, that their home nurse is trained, and that's not the case. And that's something that I keep pointing out to our subspecialties and our discharge coordinators, is that we cannot assume that these nurses that are taking on these roles for these kids when they go home are trained in this, because more often than not, they aren't. Unless they've had a kid prior to this, they normally get trained from the parents. It's not a good situation. It's not a safe situation, and we're aware of that. And also, these kids are mainstreamed a lot of times as they get older. So we have older kids and trachs who go to school, and we now train the onboarding training for the special school district nurses for St. Louis County. But prior to that, we had a death that was correctable and preventable in a school because a nurse wasn't trained, and EMS was trained. They got there and they changed out. They swapped out that trach immediately. In fact, the same exact crew who ran Sean, but it was too late. You know, they got Ross back immediately, but it was like one of those first scenarios. She already had an injury, that a cerebral injury, it was too great to recover from. So that was a long answer for, yes, the parents are trained. Sometimes we have to keep them for very long periods of time to get that done and to get everybody on the floors at the comfort level for them to go home, but we can't always prove that it's enough or guarantee it's enough.
I would only add that, just from a kind of practical organizational standpoint, that type of training is hospital-based before they get discharged, all that kind of thing. And although Trish works really closely with our trach teams and ENT in that, that type of training isn't, that part of the training isn't something that's routinely part of the STARS program. We rely on the hospital to have the families trained before they leave, and they get very extensive training. So we're generally comfortable, most of the time we're comfortable with the level of training they have when they go. We do have families that, you know, that we're a little bit nervous about, that maybe haven't shown as much proficiency as we'd like, but we definitely rely on the hospital to do most of that part of the training.
Another thing we see, I write a lot of times to keep parents at the bedside. We have parents that assume that they're handing their kid off to a higher level of care and they want to have their own vehicle. So we've seen, you know, longer transports where these plugs have occurred in or out, and there wasn't the caregiver at the bedside. And we had an incident where I found out secondhand from a discharge coordinator that one of our private services was not allowing parents at the bedside to take kids home. And we got that corrected immediately because I couldn't guarantee, as they were taking these vent babies home, that the medics in the back were trained. So we have to be careful with that as well.
Awesome, thank you both. Our next question is, do your paramedic units carry trach tubes for reinsertion and flexible catheters for suction, or have they been instructed to use ETTs?
So we have very few ambulance services and emergency departments who are really, really involved in STARS and very passionate about it, who have on their own decided to purchase the size trachs and brands of trachs that the kids in their area have, but mostly no. The answer is no. Some of our flight services have like the most common adult sizes, but we encourage them to, that's why we say grab that trach bag, you know, make sure you have that kid's equipment in the back, because honestly, even if you're going to a tertiary center, there's a chance they're not going to have that trach at the bedside when you arrive at the ER, because some of these are custom. And we would certainly never expect EMS to carry all of these different sizes of trachs that are going to expire on the shelf most likely. So we would encourage them to first reuse the trach that if they had to, if they didn't have a second one, while that sounds dirty, it's the safest airway the kid can have. And it's not a sterile procedure. But yes, we encourage them to use an ET tube if all else fails and they don't have an alternative. As far as suction catheters go, I don't know, I can't speak nationally, but for Missouri and Illinois, most of our ambulances per the EMSC carry all the way down to, I want to say it's like a size 8 and 6 French cath, which usually size 6 is usually the smallest we would see our kids have. So they usually have the correct size suction catheters, but that's another reason to grab the bag and have it with you.
Wonderful. And we've had a lot of questions and comments about if we can share the links to those videos. I just want to make sure I say while everyone's listening that when I post the recording, I'll be sure to edit in those videos to the part of the presentation where they are. Those will all be made available to everyone. So in the recorded version, you'll be able to watch those videos, and I'll email them directly to everyone in attendance. And then, so we do have a few more questions, and if you have any more, please go and send them in. But what's the best thing for a BLS truck with a kid on a vent that you would recommend? Would you recommend calling ALS, or if the kid is stable, can they transport as a BLS unit?
I would say if they don't have parents that can accompany them and troubleshoot, and if their protocol does not allow them to go all the way to an emergency trach change, that absolutely not. They should not have that baby in the back. I think that is just asking for a catastrophic event to occur. I do not think that's safe. And I think I can speak for Dr. Laffey in saying we don't think that's safe. And that's why, that's one of the reasons why we think, especially in like our state in Missouri, we have several kids who are gonna, it's gonna be an hour before they see an advanced life support unit. We believe, you know, if the alternative is death, that an EMT basic should be able to address a trach patency issue. Because, you know, no, they're not the most skilled provider, but we do believe that they can definitely be trained to proficiently be able to do it.
This question has come up when we've talked about transporting patients from the hospital back to the place in St. Louis called Rankin Jordan, which is their bridge hospital, you know, the long term. And they may be very stable on a, you know, vent. And can we send this kid by a BLS unit? And we've been absolutely, no way. You cannot put this kid in the back of an ambulance without someone in there who is comfortable and adequately trained to deal with a plug trach. It's absolutely crazy to do that. People really would scratch their heads. They were like, what are you talking about? And like, no. So we've had that come up several times. Not recently, I think that's one of those things that we've kind of been able to get people realize that's a bad idea.
And that, and when we do classes, it's hard. We try to do training with agencies that when we send kids home to rural agencies, and more often than not, the volunteer fire department will come because they want to learn too. And they want to do everything they can to support this family coming home to their community with their kid. And the first questions they have is, can I do this as an EMT? And I'm like, we have to talk to your medical director. I don't want to, you know, it's a very hard answer when in a lot of state guidelines, it says absolutely not. But again, when the alternative is death, you know, you have to weigh out your risk versus benefit, I think, in those situations. And I agree, we're talking about an airway at this point, an airway obstruction. So I think it's reasonable to teach this skill to EMT basics. I don't go ahead.
Yeah, I think it's kind of, I don't know, I think it's very liberating. You know, it's these guys, one of the things that they are supposed to do is some basic airway management. That's what, you know, one of the B's of their basic is doing some basic airway management. And, you know, I'm sure that they go through airway obstruction, relief of airway obstruction through heart association, right? It's a basic skill. This is the relief of an airway obstruction, and it's as simple as that. And when they're going south and you recognize it's obstructed, I teach the people, what do you do when you have an airway obstruction? What's your number one goal? Get rid of the obstruction. And you'll see them recognize the obstruction when you're going through this scenario. Everyone knows it's plugged. You know, free the mind. How do I get this? How do I relieve this obstruction? I take the obstruction out of the airway. And that's no matter what else you have, even if you have nothing else, I give them the Mojave Desert example. You're in the middle of the desert. There's nothing for 500 miles. What are you going to do? You still take the trach out. You have to take it out. It's got to come out. It just can't stay in. It's got to come out. It's you know, it's like leaving the grape in the airway. You just, there's no benefit to it. So I think when you start getting down to the basics like that, like I said, kind of free the mind a little.
Wonderful. I think so far we've addressed everything that people have sent in, other than I just want to reiterate, I'll be sure to send everybody links and files and everything that we've referenced. I'll put together a whole folder of stuff and I'll be sure to send that all out to everybody. I'll follow up with afterwards with you, Tricia and Dr. Laffey, and we can get all that stuff put together, and I'll be sure to send it out to everyone. But thank you so much for sharing with us. It's been super valuable information, and I really appreciate you being here and talking with us. Do you have anything you wanted to go ahead and say before we wrap up?
I just wanted to thank you all for attending. This is very, very important to us. And also my email address is up there, and I am more than happy to provide any training tools, tips, questions, anything that anybody is interested in. And if I don't have the answer, I have a hospital full of experts to turn to. So please don't hesitate to send any questions or follow-up.